I think we're waiting for Holly. And did anyone hear from Jay about whether or not he was going to be on?
I haven't heard anything though. He's pretty regular though.
Holly looks
Good.
like she's on. She's just muted.
Oh.
I don't know. Maybe she's trying to figure out how to unmute her.
Or maybe she just logged on and went stepped away to do this or something before everyone else got on.
Yeah, maybe. Okay.
This is Holly. I've been pushing buttons and I'm now unmuted.
Yay!
So, I hear Jen's voice. Who else is on?
I'm here.
Paul?
Paul. Yeah. Yep.
This is Pete.
Pete, okay. So, is that it right now, right? Four of us?
Yeah, and Jen Gannett is on, but that's it right now. So, you got the email. Carolyn won't be on today.
Carolyn won't be on.
The Department of Public Health is having a meeting this morning. I guess they just set it up over the weekend because they had an emergency meeting on Friday with the restaurant stuff.
So
does that mean we can't do that?
You are just.
She was the one who had them.
Go ahead, Jen.
No, I'm just saying, so we won't be able to review and approve minutes because unless she sent them to you.
No.
I don't have them.
Yeah, I think we'll just skip that part of it. Everybody is just calling in, right? Not on video.
I'm calling in. I didn't think you wanted to see my floofy hair because I haven't started yet.
Well, I did the computer hookup, but if nobody else is, I'm not worried about it. So, okay, so we're going to, I guess we'll get started. We're a few minutes after. I'm happy to move the agenda forward today, and then we can talk about going forward from that. So as far as any minutes, we're just going to table that for now. I do know there's an issue with minutes where previously we were submitting approved minutes through the select board's office, but I think there was some confusion of responsibility. I'll say it in a very polite way. None of our minutes from the start of this committee work have ever been posted. So we kind of have to dig through what's been approved and get all those out there. So I'm happy now that these are being recorded because we don't have to submit them going forward, which is great. So it's basically the ones we have to catch up with. Okay, so the next bullet under old business, we need to talk about chair responsibilities and this committee structure. And it's something that we continue to kind of go circle around, but I have other work in the community that I'm involved in, the South Deerfield Women's Club, where I'm on the, I'm actually a officer, I'm the treasurer. So I cannot take this on completely as a chair. As much as I would like to, I have to be honest as far as my total availability for the chair work. I am happy to propose sharing the chair position. And I know this might be contrary to a lot of committees, but share it, whether we do it for 3 months at a time, just for this next year to see where we're at. And we maybe get a few volunteers to step up and, you know, essentially chair the meeting, keep us on track with the agenda, keep the conversations, you know, moving through the items we expect to cover. But I can't take it on fully. And I know with conversations with Carolyn, with us and independently, she has too much on her plate to also chair completely. So I don't know what you guys think of a proposal of maybe a few of us pitching in for either like a 3-month stint in a row and then the next person takes it on. You know, the two things that a chair is going to do is one, develop the agenda and get it posted before the meeting. And it's got to be timely more than 48 business hours ahead of when we meet. And that's really easy to do. And then it's take the responsibility of just running the meeting. We could split those responsibilities in half and maybe have one person in charge of the agenda all the time and getting it posted. And then a couple of us taking turns running the meeting. But just, I guess, going around the table, what's your thoughts on this? Paul, you first.
I'm going to be honest with you. I don't know if I'm the only one speaking out of turn here, but I'm back at work now. And to say the least, my schedule is, who the hell knows? I mean, I've got 5 branch audits I've got to, throughout the state that I've got to get. I'm also chair of Deerfield Economic Development Industrial Corporation, which we're going through some challenging times with the select board right now. This month is going to prove very interesting to me. And I'm going to be quite honest with you, it'll determine whether I stay on any committees at all, depending on how things meter out with my activities there. But my activities with as chair of that board, you know, because like I say, we manage and run the industrial park. And Holly, you've got a good, somebody's got their phone on, I think, or I'm getting feedback. I don't know, not sure. But anyway. Thank you. Well, still hear it. Gone now. I agree with Holly. Somehow, kind of share this because, like I say, I know for me, and I'm not gonna lie to you. Like I say, my plate is full. Between work coming back now, we haven't even opened up our branches, never mind our offices. A lot of stuff being off 2 months away from a lot of systems. So, and then, like I say, I've got some. I got a few mountains to climb here with Dedek and the select board. Having some issues. And like I say, and I'm going to be quite honest with all of you, this could determine whether I stay or I go, depending on how things, like I say, meter out before the end of the month. Decisions have to be made, the appointments have to be made before June 30th. So anyways.
Paul, yeah. Does that mean yeah. It impact your staying on this committee as well?
Yeah, I can't work. I can't work with individuals that, you know, if I'm getting bullied, I'll just leave it at that. Hopefully things resolve themselves, but things have developed in the last few weeks that give me pause. And having been on it since 93, I'm getting tired of it. And so I don't want to say, and it's not a threat or anything. I want to do it. It's just very hard to get thrown off one thing and then something the other. And I could be putting the cart before the horse, but all my life here and knowing how people operate in politics in town and what have you, I've just got to keep my options open. So, but I agree with you. It's got to be a shared thing because all of us are busy. I know Linda with her involvement with the Women's Club, the busyness, you as treasurer. So I get that. Totally get that. And,
okay, so I guess we'll just we'll have to see how that moves forward. Pete,
yeah,
what
are like I say, I'll know more by the honor before the end of the month.
Okay, that sounds good. Pete, your thoughts?
Yeah, I think it's a shared responsibility, given where we are, is a good option. My biggest problem is I'm not there. I'm up in Vermont right now, and I'm bouncing back and forth. But I do believe that I could attend meetings. So I will, if you wish, I would be willing to run the meetings if somebody can do the legwork to get stuff into the office and whatever that needs to happen in terms of the agenda or the notices.
Okay, so you're proposing you would be willing when you attend to run the meetings, and if someone took on the agenda preparation and posting as a split duty, that would be workable for you.
Yeah, I think so. I've just been watching you and other folks doing it, and it's sort of like you have to come into the office, and if somebody isn't in there or you're not quite sure and whatever, and I'm just not there enough to be able to manage that piece of it, but I could probably chair a meeting and keep the cats in order at least.
Okay, thank you, Pete. Jen, your thoughts?
My thoughts, so in the booklet that I got, which is, has the binding on the side, has the different committees that were listed throughout when they did this in the 70s. And for the executive committee, they had a chair, an executive secretary, a secretary, a vice chair, and a treasurer. But it sounds like we don't have enough volunteers to do anything like that at this point.
There was much more involvement back then. I'll just say that. So, yeah, I know. Yeah. Life is different.
No, I understand. Yeah, because there's two pages, or actually three pages. One, two, three full pages, three and a half people who volunteered to do things. Different committees.
Yeah, I remember people lining up. Everybody was involved. Really was.
I'm coming back full circle to when I first joined this committee, and I joined it the second meeting in, and there was the notion to keep a smaller group for voting purposes, so that way we didn't have to reinvent the wheel with too many voices at the table for voting for particular approvals of different, you know, events or spending or so forth. But my argument then was that I can speak for myself at 66. I will be 69 at the anniversary point. And there are some people on the committee, we don't have to roll out all the ages, who are older than me. And we really need active boots on the ground, folks who would be part of this. So I guess I need to come back to, I don't know if we need to solicit to enhance this committee further so that we could do more of a setup of responsibilities as we had 50-ish years ago. Because right now there's just too few of us. And, you know, Jen, you joined us simply because you're chairing fundraising. And you're an incredibly good to our group. But I think that you have your plate full for the next year or two with some of the things you're going to be doing in order to get to where we need to be. And so, you know, obviously chairing two things is not, you know, really what your place would be.
I
totally support you on that. I think though that we're almost too few to pass things around. Kathy Melnick is technically a member of this committee but hasn't participated in a meeting now for several months, so I think I'm going to reach out to her after this to see what her decision point is. Hi, Jay. I know you just joined us. I'm almost thinking to mitigate some of these issues, we need to enhance the makeup of this committee and add some bodies. And I just don't know how we do it. If we do it through the select board, if we do it with some kind of posting on the town webpage, I honestly don't know how we would start this process. Paul, would you have any thoughts, because you've been on committees, as far as how you generate additional support?
Well, in our case with DDIC, because of the structure, the way it was set up by the legislature, the select board are the ones that, you know, there's a set limit. They appoint or they seek recommendations from the current board members or whatever for, you know, additional. So that's always been that case. I mean, you know, you have various boards in the town that are appointed by the select board. I agree with you. I think that, you know, what went on 50 years ago, I remember everyone was active, and I do. I remember a lot of good folks are gone from us now, but there was a lot of activity and involvement. And I think maybe the select board, you know, and the website and some kind of structure and say, hey, we need help. I mean, you go down to the town offices and you can see the big poster that they have. You know, they need folks for the fire department, you know, they need volunteers for this, that. So, you know, it's put out there. But this, yeah, I think this, using the select board as a voice is one thing. I think the town website, you know, making it very clear, trying to entice, because I agree with you, we only have so many people. I mean, there's only so many, we can only carry so many dishes at one time. You know, and given the rest of our, what's going on in our lives. So, yeah, that's what I think.
This is Jen popping on again. So regarding the three and a half pages of volunteers, those were like subcommittee things once people decided what events were going on. And that's why I sent in my other email the other day, the two pages of, you know, different events that they had that particular year. So, you know, everyone could see what was kind of going on and how they did it. And it was like over the course of, you know, just a couple of weeks or a month, you know, they'd have something every weekend. And, you know, I'm more than happy to rotate, to take on some responsibilities for some things as it goes around. I just guess I feel like there would be a conflict of interest, you know, being a chairperson for the fundraising committee and for the steering committee.
I totally agree, Jen, and I support you on that. So let me, I guess with permission of this group, I would like to reach back out through the select board to have them, I can write up just a little paragraph that we're looking for some interest in serving on the steering committee and subsequently on subcommittees as we go forward, and see what kind of interest we might, you know, entertain. Because I think we've got to add some players. I know, Jen, just as you have other responsibilities, Paul and I were hoping to have some chairing responsibility for the parade as a subcommittee. And right. We do have some information to share on that. So, you know, as we go forward, the layers of responsibilities are going to become more complex as we jump and handle other things. So, you know, if someone simply is chairing this committee and not chairing another piece of it, you know, that kind of leaves the responsibility less complex for this committee. But if you're going to be jumping off and doing subsequent things, which many of us have already said we would, that's where I think having some additional representation is going to be very helpful.
I think that's important. My question is, you know, and maybe I shouldn't ask, but, you know, we had quite a few people who were on it before and then they stepped down. I don't know if that plays into getting more people.
Yeah, I guess you could put it that way.
I'm not sure I understand what I'm just
saying, like, you know, with Paul mentioning that there's conflicts on, I don't remember which committee or thing that you're on as well. But I just wonder if there's going to be conflict of interest for other people through other experiences, and I'm hoping that's not the case.
Like I say, hopefully I'll have a clearer picture before the end of the month where I'm going with this. Holly and I, and she'll shed more light with the parade stuff. The meeting we had alone, I mean, it's the parade committee, subcommittee, whatever I want to call it. My God, what that's going to entail involved is
a lot of work.
But it's quite something. And luckily, we had a good meeting the other night, so I'll let her share that. But that alone, but I agree with you. As you move along, we need more than three or four people. You know what I mean? You're just going to have to. You're going to have more people.
Okay, so to move this along, is everyone okay with me reaching out to the select board and maybe getting something posted on the webpage? Jen, your thoughts?
Yes, I think that's fine with me. I think we need more people.
Okay, Paul?
Oh, yeah, I agree. I don't know. I'm not attending tonight, but tonight, a town meeting would be a great, even if they just, mention it as a sidebar kind of thing. I don't know.
That's a good point. That's a good point. Pete?
Yeah, I agree. I think we need more people. And, if we've got two folks that are working, on the parade and intend to continue with that, and I'm pretty heavily into the historical stuff, and I'll have my arms full dealing with that. So, I think we definitely need more regular folks that are willing to, really pitch in.
Okay.
And maybe maybe coordinate the steering committee rather than the subcommittees.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Maybe someone just stepping up to be more on the steering side, and then the subcommittees can evolve as they have been.
Yeah, I agree.
Jay, your thoughts? You're muted, Jay. Jay, you're muted. At the bottom, there's an unmute.
Okay.
Okay, your thoughts, Jay?
Right. I think we just need a bigger net and more possible casters.
Okay, thank you. All right. Our next item on the old business is a tentative calendar, but Paul has some time constraints. So, Paul, what is your time available for today?
I can go a little bit. I've jockeyed a few things around, so I might just stay in the background because I want to hear what we had with Mike and Brenda on the parade issues. I can listen a little bit. Yeah.
Okay. So let's just talk a minute about the tentative calendar. And I reached out to the superintendent of schools to see when the graduation might be for 2023. And of course, that's looking way ahead. But he indicated to me that it would be the first Friday. So that would be the 2nd of June, I believe, if I have that calendar right. And he said that prom is usually sometime in May, but that's kind of variable. I did ask also about seniors participating if there was an event after graduation, and he said that would be voluntary. But if we did something the weekend of June 9th, 10th, 11th, again, if I have the right dates in front of me, that he wouldn't dismiss the seniors being involved, but it would be a more voluntary basis. So I know we were looking at those couple of weekends for more of the big weekend. Any comments from anyone on that? Jen, you could start.
No, you're right with the dates for that particular time frame. I think we had talked about the 3rd or the 10th, And then you said the Friday that would be the graduation, the 2nd, or would it be the Saturday after?
Graduation's always Friday night.
Okay, so it would be the 2nd.
Correct.
So if we did something on the 3rd, that's a meet, you know, graduation weekend, we may not get a lot of participation.
Right.
And then the 2nd weekend, you know, is after, but our, I guess the only concern would be with their activity in the parade, how many of the, you know, seniors would be in the band or in one of the other things with it.
Well, Sunderland had their Father's Day weekend, and they would have had the same dilemma, whether or not seniors participated or not. And it didn't seem to be a problem. And we'll jump into more about the parade, but they said they put the Frontier Band at the beginning of the parade, so those kids could jump out and either just be done so they didn't have to hang around as long and or watch the rest of the parade. So it didn't seem to be an issue for Sunderland.
Yeah, so that's my own, that would be my only comment as to whether or not they would participate. And if, you know, I don't think most of them are going away the weekend after for college until the fall. So, I mean, and just curious, because looking at, I know you checked with the local thing, but through this parade booklet and everything else, was just looking at who was in it the last time, there were some, and I didn't send those pages over, my apologies. You know, if you wanted Deerfield Academy to participate in anything or any floats or whatever, when do they get out of school for that year would be my only comment.
I think Deerfield Academy graduates the last Sunday of May or Saturday. I think it's, it may be Memorial Day weekend if Memorial Day runs late, or it may be the weekend after Memorial Day if Memorial Day is early. But I think they're usually the weekend ahead of Frontier. Paul, would you know that?
What's that again? I'm trying to.
Deerfield Academy, do they normally graduate the weekend before Frontier?
They seem to. God, I don't pay much attention, but it seems like they're out, I think, yeah, before. I think it's like a week before Frontier. I don't think it's after. It doesn't stick in my memory as such. And they're close, but I don't think they don't fall. But I think it's just before Frontier.
Yeah, that's what I think so too.
Yeah, and the parade last time happened on July 8th on a Sunday. So I don't know if that was the grand parade. So I guess, you know, it wasn't that big of a deal then.
Yeah.
It was also done around. And other activities that were done in that time frame, like, were class reunions. So I don't know if that's something that normally would happen.
That's actually a good suggestion, because it would be a great time for, you know, previous classes to get together, you know, surrounding.
You have the email that I sent to all of you with the program of events. If you could pull that up, those two pictures, because that has all of the different events that they did, and that's why I sent it, to kind of give everybody a general idea, and that way we could kind of guesstimate a time frame. And obviously it doesn't have to be identical, we don't need to recreate the exact thing, but it gives us a basis as to where it was 50 years ago and what people were interested in then, and then we could see, you know, would people still be interested in these things today.
I think just retrospectively looking at how they did it with themes, I thought that was pretty cool, because it really pulled in a lot of different populations with the various themes of, you know, a teen thing and then sports. And, you know, I think it was kind of neat how they did that. And so it got me thinking, you know, obviously to move things forward, but, you know, to today and what we have. I just think it's interesting that they chose to pocket things in that way. So it really generate interest. I thought that was kind of cool.
And to build on some of these days, like for example, if you look at they had historic tour days that were not just, I mean, they were old Deerfield, but there's also stuff that the Historic Commission is currently working on to get a walking tour for and getting things historic, labeled historic along North Main Street here in South Deerfield. So if that one is done and you know, notified. The Mass Cultural Council has various grants that I was looking into for support that you could get, you know, somewhere between $500 to $2,000, depending on what it is, for different events like this, for like the historic tour days. And I know that we had talked about someone doing oral histories. There's a grant on here that's up to around $2,000. I don't know if they'll still be doing it for 2021 timeframe and whatnot, but you know, they had a lot of different things with this. So, and for cultural things like the Polka Festival is a Polish heritage thing, you could possibly apply for a separate grant for that particular one as well.
And what is that with again? The where do you apply?
So there are grants through the masshumanities.org. If you, there's different cultural council programs, and the Mass Humanity grants, they have it. I'm just looking at the different things. Like there's a project grant, like if someone wants to do a documentary, there's education stuff. If someone wanted to do, where is it here? Research inventory grants, like Peter could do stuff, I mean, like for the historical part, and he, you know, research. There's a local history grant for up to $3,500. But then there was also another one here that I found a couple others, you know, that were around $500 in different pieces.
Mm-hmm. Is it something you could send all of us the link to that so we could look at it before the next meeting?
Yeah, I can. And this is also something the fundraising committee is, you know, working on too.
Mm-hmm.
So, but this, the reason that I mention it is to, once I have the definitive information, you know, it just could go towards supporting some of these different events in a specific way. So that way, if we're looking for the person who wanted to do oral histories, maybe we set up a booth, you know, on one day or in town hall for someone to come in and give their oral history for, you know, for a week or something. And that could be sponsored through that and help pay for it. So, you know, there's a variety of them.
Mm-hmm. That sounds great.
And, yeah. And the other thing too, when looking on here, we look at program of events about like arts and crafts exhibits and things like that. You can do it through the grade school, through the high school, and then you could also do one, you know, where you have a local artist come in and do something, you know, and have a display and maybe do an arts night out or, you know, a competition along those lines or something for that. Mm-hmm. And that could possibly be funded in some way for that, whether, you know, you could use the money for advertising or other purposes with it.
Mm-hmm. Sounds great. Thank you, Jen.
You're welcome.
Swinging back into our agenda. So we've really only talked about this potential weekend for the parade. Given some of the feedback, do we want to leave the tentative dates for the weekend of the 9th, 10th, 11th, having the parade on the Saturday, the 10th? Any thoughts, Paul?
Say it again. So leave it Saturday, the 10th? As the formal?
As the parade date.
Okay. Well, I mean, it's by guess or by God. I mean, you know, we throw something out there and hope it sticks.
Well, I think right now we're doing tentative. I don't think we're locking anything down, but, you know,
oh, no.
exploring other things like what, you know, Jennifer was just talking about with different, you know, cultural events or town history and things like that. Yeah. I have other things happening during the year at various points. Right. But I think right. some things like the date of a kickoff party and the parade yeah. are kind of big anchor things that we need to work around. And then once we solidify a few of the anchors, then I think we right. can start filling in the calendar from there.
Yeah, no, I think the anchors, and be interesting if anyone's still around, if I have to look at those names. Is there anyone, I got to take that list. Jennifer, when you sent that page, were the committee members on that what you sent to?
No, they were not. What I can do is I can make take some photos of some other pages and send those over if you all want.
Can you with the committee members? I just want to see if anyone is still with us.
I could quickly just tell you that. Hold on.
I think rather than going through all of that now,
I'll send it out.
I want to keep some of these topics moving. So
Right.
So Paul, are you okay with tentatively looking at that second weekend of June for our big events?
I mean, it seems to work. It doesn't, you know, it doesn't go loggerheads with anything else, the best we know, with graduations, okay. whatever. I guess.
And then I'm using the word tentative for right now.
Oh yeah, no. You got to. I mean, we've got okay. that 3-year window, okay. but yeah.
Pete, your thoughts?
Yeah, I had a couple of thoughts. I think that's a reasonable way to approach this and probably a good time frame. Just so we know historically, the best date for the founding or the creation of what became Deerfield is May 7th. So what I would suggest is that if we use the June date, that we can use the month of May to have one or more events to try and frame Deerfield's history for the general public.
That's a great idea.
The other thing I was thinking about is I don't know whether the high school would have it or not, but our class secretary, I was a class of 62, and Jeannie Olanek, who lives at Waitley, is a class secretary, but she sends out stuff on the internet and corrals us when there are class reunions and stuff. And I'm just wondering if we got a list of the secretaries for the various classes out of Frontier, whether we could use those folks to reach out to the other folks in their class to help us coordinate some of these events or find participants or make suggestions about what people would like to see.
I'm going to tell you something right now, having gone to try to resurrect our class reunion, that's difficult. Frontier really doesn't have anything, but what they do have, and I don't know what's left of it since Lucy Melnick passed, and I think Jeannie Gripko is still involved with it, but they had a reunion committee that represented all the classes of the old Deerfield High School, pre-Frontier, and they do assemble, and they're still a group. And I want to say, you know, so we have a name like that, not to digress any further, but, you know, I know what we've done. Some classes haven't met, I can tell you, others have. It's you know, I can give you a few, but it's going to really, you know, I don't know. I mean, maybe Frontier can provide something. When we resurrected our class and finding everybody, which was a year-long process, we pretty much relied on Facebook and Google and the like. So, but it's a good thought.
Maybe we should just put FRS and Deerfield alum on a future agenda so we could explore that more.
Yeah.
Okay. Jay, your thoughts? You're muted.
Looking good. So much happens between now and then. We have to be open for other things to happen. I'm hoping that we'll be able to get firm commitment from at least maybe 20 people who can either be the point person or the backup for that. We're not anywhere near that point yet. But this way, if somebody has to not be with us, we do have a backup. And I think asking people, can you be a backup? We won't call you unless we need it.
Mm-hmm.
We need that. My experience is that most people say, yeah, sure, it's fine, which at least makes us a step toward that direction, just figuring out something does go wrong. Murphy is always with us. And, you know, Murphy says what I say is what happens. So we just have to be prepared for that. I'm glad that we're doing this a couple of years in advance. Doesn't make me nervous at this point.
Good point, Jay. Thank you. Jen, any thoughts?
I'm totally open to that particular weekend. I think doing something special on the Founders Day gives us an additional date for the calendar of events. So May 7th should be something, and we can talk about whatever. The other thing that I noticed in this book and that was mentioned a few times is another event is the Torch of Friendship and Peace. Between the, you know, the Mohawk Nation, I guess is what it was here, and, you know, the town of Deerfield. I don't know if we want to maybe, you know, get in touch with, in this book, it talked about the Indians of Quebec Association worked together to do this so that they lit up in February. It was February 16th. They did, you know, something with the president of the Indians of Quebec Association and the chairman of the Deerfield Board of Selectmen, you know, to recognize the conflict between the two communities and then coming together. It might just be good to relight it and do something along those lines as another event, you know, earlier in the year.
I think Paul could shed a little light on it because he remembers this as a school-age person participating.
You talking when they were the
torch?
Yeah, they did that up at they did that at DA. Remember the two kids? They were elementary school kids. One dressed as a settler, the other in you know Indian American, you know, Native American dress for the.
Yeah, the kids' names are James J. Lotka, Gail Leno, Kathleen Crook, and Todd Allen. They're in the book thing that I have.
Yep, Jimmy John is still, far as I know, living on Fair Street. Don't know. What was the girl? Was it a girl? A young girl?
Gail Leno and Kathleen Crook, K-R-U-K.
Oh, Crook? What was the
Gail Leno and Kathleen Crook and Todd Allen.
Unfortunately, Kathleen has left us. But the Bill Leno, who used to be the town treasurer, I believe that's one of his daughters. He had one daughter. But anyways, so two of the three are still around. But yes, they shipped us all up to, they shut down Frontier. They bussed everyone from Frontier, the elementary school, and everyone attended the lighting of that torch, and that stayed there for a while. Until I don't know, as warmer weather came. I don't think it burned like a Olympic flame during the entire year, but I remember that was an event they had. It was in, I want to say February. Is that about
it was
right?
February 16th, yep.
Yeah, okay, yep. And that's back when we got snow on the ground, by the way. So, so yep. That one, I thought that was well. Go ahead.
I just thought it was something, you know, to maybe recreate it again because it's something earlier in the season, you know, the year. Just to solidify that unity and friendship and peace, right, especially during all the things going on in the world now.
Well, yeah, I mean, I think that would be a great gesture, you know, thing.
So it looks like we've got four kind of key things right now we're talking about. We're talking about a kickoff event on or around New Year's Eve. Something to do with the torch, and if we keep with what the prior tradition was, that would be in the winter months, probably February-ish, and then having a Founders Day event in May around the 7th. What does the 7th fall on? Anybody have
1 second? I dropped that here for 2023, right?
Yeah, 2023.
May 7th is on a Sunday.
May 7th on 2023. Oh, cool. That's a Sunday.
Yeah. So
that's really good. And then right now we're tentatively going to look at the weekend of the 9th, 10th, 11th for major events, parade being on the Saturday, the 10th.
Right. And okay. The gala, the New Year's Eve gala kickoff celebration, would we want to do that on New Year's Eve, which is a Saturday night, or would we want to do it a different time?
I guess let's go around the table. Pete?
And let me just mention this real fast to give you an alternative date. January 7th is also a Saturday, because I know people mentioned if people were doing something with their families or friends, but, you know, just throwing that out there.
Pete, you're...
I'm sort of open for anything. I just had a thought. I'm trying to remember what it was. You mentioned the torch. There's also a reconciliation memorial stone in the front yard of the library that could be a point of meeting or celebration as well.
Yeah, and they did. I remember it wasn't as big of an event, but I do remember when they unveiled that thing. Yes, agreed.
Yeah, it had to do with Deerfield's big 1704 celebration, where they got communities coming down from Montreal and
is there a date that stone was laid? Do you know?
Pardon?
Is there a date surrounding when that stone was laid or unveiled?
I could find out for you.
Yeah, that might be good, because then, you know, if it is part of the history, to work that in at the appropriate time.
Yeah, my father was chair of the committee and on the chair of the library, so I can find that out. Although he's gone, there's folks I can ask.
Okay, so either date would work for you for the gala.
Yeah, I'm fine.
Okay, Jay.
Yeah, fine. Either date.
Okay, Paul.
Yeah, I mean, we'll go. Work something out. Yeah.
Okay. Jen, does your committee have a preference?
No, we didn't have a preference. The other thing to mention on the program of events for the 300th, they called it a Queen's Ball. So, and it was held at the Deerfield Academy Dining Hall. So I think that's where we had talked about having it, was at Deerfield Academy, and that would be a town ask, I believe.
Yes, it would be a town ask, and I did find it interesting that that's where we were thinking about, and that's where it was held, which was, you know, kind of cool to see that it was there 50 years ago.
Yeah, I thought, you know, I think it's great, and, you know, we could do it as our kickoff, our kickoff event, and advertise it as that, and then, you know, so either date works, because I think you're going to get interest regardless of the date that you have it.
Right. I agree with you.
Whether,
you know, part of it, New Year's Eve being anticipatory, where, you know, we would have a toast at midnight to start the year. But honestly, if it's a week later, you know, I think, you know, maybe DA through the town ask might have a preference, and then that might kind of drive the cart for us.
Yeah, but I think Carolyn mentioned at our last meeting that we had to come up with a list of everything that we wanted, so they would do one ask and not multiple.
I think they meet with them quarterly, so I think obviously that would be an important date we'd want to get shored up. I don't think we have to wait to get everything in a list. I think if we okay. go that one date for them to inquire about, that at least will help start filling in our calendar. So I think, you know, we should probably just have your committee circle back with Carolyn and or the full select board and see if they can inquire on that. Do any of you remember that Carolyn said we had to do anything different other than throw quarterly requests through her? Okay, I guess, why don't you have your committee check back through the select board to see if we could at least shore up that one date?
Okay, I will, I'll ask.
Okay, so moving on to new business. Jennifer, you're gonna give us a fundraising subcommittee report?
Yep, so you don't wanna talk about any other dates on the calendar at this point?
Is there...
I think one of the comments that, you know, that the fundraising committee had was they wanted to kind of see whether or not, you know, there were other large events that we had to raise money for and kind of, you know, build it around that, because without knowing about the larger events other than the gala and the parade, it was, you know, we just kind of wanted to have a general idea as to what prime points throughout the year. I mean, obviously, we're going to look at getting the majority of the funding done before the big events for the parade, you know, shore up everything probably for like April deadline for donations towards that. So I guess I was assuming because it was on the agenda, we were going to talk more about it. Everyone still here?
Yep, I'm here.
Oh, okay. It just went really quiet. I didn't know. So I think the majority of you were on our fundraising committee phone call.
Well, I was.
That we
yes.
had. Let me just look at some things here.
It was.
Whose phone's on?
The 15th, when you met?
Yeah, that's when we met. We didn't have another meeting since. We're meeting again in June, later this month. The things in here, we have a draft thank you letter that we're working on to make some modifications to. I'm waiting for some information back about sizing, you know, getting less expensive quotes for the printing on that. I followed up with Trevor regarding the use of whether or not we could use the town seal, because a couple people are someone on the committee, the fundraising committee, said that in the past they were told they weren't allowed to use it. So I just, you know, want to solidify and clarify those things, because I guess when the previous town administrator Wendy was here, it was something that was told they couldn't use. So that's just something we're working on, finding out that information. The cost, or so a big piece that I found pertaining to the parade, and this is not to overstep anything with you and Paul, Holly, it's just the way that they did this booklet and how you talked about putting a banner up with, you know, who made the donations for each float sponsorship. And one of the things in this book, and obviously we can do whatever we want, I'm just giving feedback of historical usage. They have a good amount of donors on here. Like, people took out a full page ad, a half page ad, a quarter page ad, and everything's done in this this brownish, you know, off-white coloring throughout the whole entire thing. So nothing's in color per se. It's just two colors for this. And they have a list of all the parade floats. And if there was a specific, sponsorship for that float, it was listed. Like Division One, you know, and it gives you all the different companies or organizations that they had marching in the parade. So I think I'm going to send this, make copies of this, or you know, send pictures over so you can see. Like your South Deerfield Women's Club had a float. The Deerfield Women's Club had a float. The Cub Scouts, Girl Scouts, the Polka Festival, you know, these different places had floats. And then there were other ones that were just marching structure, like the Mass State Police, the Deerfield Police Cruiser, the Marshal. And then that Torch of Friendship and Peace also had a float. So, and then it goes down to other divisions, what they considered, and it said sponsored by, one was Skibisky Enterprises and Ralph T. Saab, Inc., you know, and they sponsored, you know, the Lieutenant Norman Prince Renegade Senior Drum and Bugle Corps out of Boston.
I don't want to jump ahead,
how it is.
Jen, but kind of along the same lines, and Paul and I will talk a bit more about the parade, but Sunderland gave us their booklet when we met with Mike and Brenda Wojnarowicz. And their booklet has parade divisions, and they have each thing that's in it. And then if there's a sponsor, they
that's exactly what this is.
And it's pretty good because the anyway. So their information in conjunction with our 50-year-old information, I think, is going to give us some nice means of looking at everything. And they did a booklet just for the parade, just
awesome.
A little. So that's pretty cool because it gives us just the snapshot of the parade. Anyway, I didn't want to interfere, but. It's along the same lines of what you're going to share. After we talk about this today, I'm going to make some copies of Sunderland's parade stuff as well, just to share with everybody.
No, that's great. So the reason I was looking at the different names and such for the fundraising portion was because you're going to provide, you know, you're going to have the general idea. You talked about, like, you know, the cost from WAS and all of them for the parade and everything. And I think we estimated last time we talked, it was around $35,000
to $40,000
around there. And then we had the Hatfield information, which I sent over regarding some tiers. And we talked as the subcommittee a little bit about utilizing that and whether or not we wanted to do, you know, swag items and things along those lines. And, you know, my thought is I didn't want to get that complicated. Is to different swag items. It was just going to use the benefit level as to, like, you'd be on the website, the anniversary calendar, flyers, materials, banners, and signs, you know, social media, radio ads, etc. So, you know, that particular piece I think would probably work well, and that's what we're going to discuss later this month. We're working from Trevor because I didn't know. For our fundraising letters, and this was a question, do we use Town Hall as our mailing address, or do we need a P.O. box? That was a question we had, you know, and where it would be coming from, or sent to if someone mailed a check-in, attention to us, because we want to be able to track that. So is there a space that we would utilize, like, is there a... if a letter came to us, because I'm just going to be blunt. I've submitted things for certain things for town approval, and it sat on somebody's desk and didn't go to the right department. And I had to follow up, and it took me multiple months. So I'm wondering if we get mail at the town hall and it's labeled fundraising committee, is it going to go in our mailbox?
That's a really good point. I know early on, before you joined our committee, Jen, we talked about donations being made directly to the town and how they will be tracked and applied to our particular budget and not elsewhere. And I think a lot has to do with how it's identified when it comes into the town accountant to get it into the correct fund. But also jointly so that our committee and or fundraising subcommittee would have means to do thank yous for any monies that are directly donated.
Right. And that's what our concern is that when we send out our thank you letter, you know, is it the address of the town?
Yeah, I
or
think
any mail or any letters from us. Is it going to the town? Because, you know, not just tracking the fundraising, but say we send a letter out soliciting something from someone and they mail back to us. I don't want it sitting there for, you know, weeks on end and not knowing that it's there.
Correct. I think this is a good question. And I think because most of the mail that's generated for this committee, at least currently, is going to be for your subcommittee. Do you want to follow up, or would you like us as a committee to follow up with select board and town accountant to see how we do this?
Part of me is I understand there, you know, we're looking to do the online donations, and Trevor is following up as to how we go through with the Plum Fund, you know, to make sure that the right information gets to the right a person for entering it into the system. That's not the question. I guess the question is multiple pieces. One, you know, would we send something out from people? We'll probably use, you know, the town address as to where we're located out of, because it's a town organization subcommittee or committee. But if someone responds to us or wants to send in something, how do we make sure that we actually get it? I don't want sitting on somebody's desk in an office,
right?
And they, we got this for you.
I think that they, and Paul, maybe you could answer this for Dedek. Is there a mailbox within the town hall where your information is plunked for you to pick up occasionally?
Well, we have a mail. Yeah, we use the town, the 8 Conway Road or Conway Street, depending on who you talk to. We have a mailbox in there. We refer to it as Conway Road, but anyways, potato potato. Anyways, we do have a mailbox in there. We're at the mercy of someone in the town, you know, whoever has the responsibility of getting that. Hold on a second. Getting that to us, and so we are actually considering, with everything that's been going on, we're probably going to go back to a PO box for our purposes. But yes, there is the availability, and it's also where someone within the, you know, if someone was dropping something off, if you had access to the town offices, you could get in there. So. As far as I know, there is availability to create a box for us. But like I say, if it's received on at the town offices, it's up to them, you know, the town employee or whoever, to make sure it gets into the right boxes. So.
Part of me really just wants to get a PO box and make sure that, you know, whoever we have checking it and everything that we get goes right to the town for, you know, to the accountants, whoever would make the money deposit, if it's the assessor, accountant, whomever, it's the town hall, That way we're not relying on someone in town not getting it to us promptly and losing out and then making a constituent upset with us because we didn't acknowledge
right.
their donation or something got lost in the mail.
Can I be honest with you? Do a P.O. box.
Yes.
I can do a P.O. box, but I think we have to ask if it's okay.
But I think
a P.O. box.
That'll come from me directly. Not, I don't need the steering committee to do that. I'll just do it through the subcommittee and ask specifically if that's okay.
Yeah, I think this committee is short-lived. It's for a couple of years. I think the P.O. box lets us control it.
Yep.
Well, to the point that if you get cash, someone sends something in that's sensitive or what have you, you can control it and make sure it goes to the right spot and doesn't sit somewhere for a week or whatever.
5 months, just anyway. I just want to avoid that. So.
I'm looking while we're talking, and the smallest P.O. box, which would just be for envelopes, it's 3 inches by 5.5 inches. A 12-month is $76.
That's fine. That's not bad.
So I think it would be money well spent to keep control, particularly that we want to respond and thank people, deal with any other correspondence and direct it to the right committee person. So I'm in favor of that. So Jen, you are going to circle back to see if it's okay if we do this?
Now, are you asking that the steering committee also be in that or just fundraising? Because I can make a general steering committee and make sure, you know, wherever it goes. Because I think we can get more than one key if, you know, if two people need to check it.
Yeah, I think I would like it to be for the whole committee. And then, you know, whoever has to, you know, whoever does the pickup just disperses stuff to the right committee person.
Okay. Yeah, that's fine. And
so are you going to just ask the select board if it's okay if we do that?
Yeah, I'll ask the select board just to go forward. You know, I'll just send an email up. I talked to Carolyn and Trevor. Is David the other person on the select board?
David Wolfram.
Okay. So do I email them and ask them to put it on the agenda?
I guess it may have to go on the agenda. So yeah, I guess.
No.
Yeah.
Okay.
If it doesn't, they'll just give you an answer.
All right.
Hey, Holly.
Permission.
Yes, Bob.
Hey, I gotta jump off. I apologize. I just if you want to do the parade, it's in good hands. Like I said, it was a good meeting with Brent. It was a great meeting with Brenda and Mike and. You know, she has since sent those other things along. So
yeah.
I thought it was very, very informative. So
yeah, anyway. For sure. Okay Paul, thanks for being on board. Okay.
I'll talk to you later.
Paul.
Yep. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Okay. So anything else on fundraising subcommittee?
I don't think not since the meeting that we had that most of you were on. You know, we're just trying to answer those questions. And the other question that was asked was the signature on the fundraising committee letters. I was going to put, you know, the entire fundraising committee information, like, you know, the names of us. And then, you know, if someone's mailing it out specifically, it can be signed by that person. Or do you guys think that I should do it as chair?
I think either way is fine. That I think you guys can make that decision.
Okay, great.
And just as a reminder, I know we talked about the postcard information, but any communications that you draft, you'll just run by this committee before you use
them. Oh yeah. And that was the draft that we sent to all of you and you guys seem to be okay with. And that was, I think, the discussion with, you know, the mentioning of whether or not the town seal would be on the other side. So I'm just waiting to hear back from Trevor on that because he was supposed to follow up with Barbara and my email got lost in his inbox, but he found it.
Okay. Are you having trouble getting a response from Select Board? Because it sounds like you're waiting on a couple of things.
Well, I sent him the one email with multiple questions, and I followed up with Trevor. I actually sent him a message on Facebook asking him what's the best email, because I sent it to the town email and didn't get a reply. And he said, I'm sorry, it got lost. I found it. I will follow up. So I now have his individual email, Facebook contact, and the town one.
Okay. So hopefully that will move that along. But
yeah.
If you're having trouble before we meet next, then maybe when does fundraising meet next? I know I had it down.
June 22nd, I believe, is when we're meeting next.
June 22nd. Okay. So I would say if you're not having resolution before that meeting, maybe we should try to run that through Carolyn, because she's on our committee, to see if she can help facilitate moving that along.
Yeah, no problem. Trevor had just been on our call, so that's why I had sent it to him directly.
No, that's good. That's good. Okay. So what do we got else here? The kickoff event, date, type of event, and location. I think we've talked a bit as far as possible dates, but type of event. And location. Location, I guess we're leaning as we did 50 years ago with Deerfield Academy because of their space allowances. But type of event, do you want to just talk about that a bit?
Sure. So the kickoff event that we had discussed was to do the gala. Am I correct in that assumption still?
Yes.
So it would be, you know, something where we were talking about doing a black tie event, you know, something dressy, not casual, having a small band or a DJ, you know, maybe emceeing the night. In regards to, you know, the different things going on and looking at, you know, we could do, sorry, give me a moment. We could do the idea of where it was 50 years ago to make it a little more interesting. We could do a queen in her court if we so chose to do something along those lines. I don't know if people are interested in that, because then you could still maybe get high school students interested if they did it along that level, I'm unsure. And plus, I don't know how exactly you would do that nowadays, but it's just an idea from what they did 50 years ago. You know, it was something to add to it to make it a little bit more interesting. But the dinner, you know, depending on how COVID is still going, I don't know if it would be a plated meal or less expensive as a buffet. You know, things like that are going to have to be looked at as we move forward. But obviously, we would want it to be a little more fancy. And tickets-wise, depending on what the cost per person would be for this type of event at Deerfield Academy, you know, it was mentioned price per couple could be around $100. Obviously, we can go up or down with that. But we hadn't gotten too much detail into that event because we weren't sure as to the date at that point in time. So we can decide what we want to do there as we get closer to it. I don't know what your thoughts are and what everyone on this committee wants it to look like as well. I mean, while I know it's a fundraising event, you know, having it music and whatnot, you could have local speakers, you know, from the town. We could have, you know, maybe, you know, someone talk about, you know, the founding, but obviously you don't want to take too much from the founding date in May. Would we do a ceremony for that? But just to talk about, you know, what's happened in the last 50 years since the last event, you know, and kind of go along those lines, but, you know, to really celebrate where we are and where we've moved to at this point in, you know, with the community.
I think all what you mentioned sounds really great. The Queen in Court, I guess that's something to explore as we go forward. But I think making it, you know, a, when you want to call it a gala event, you want it to be a little more special than just going to have a meal and a few presenters. I think I would envision it to be more of a kickoff celebration and certainly having some voices of what's to come over the year and some reflective pieces, but maybe even intersperse that. If you have a band, sometimes a band will take a break for 10 or 15 minutes. During that time, maybe have someone do a little speaking, but not have, you know, like a half hour of speaking. Where
no, I wasn't thinking about
that. The night.
Yep.
But, you know, I love the idea of making it a little fancy, of making it fun, you know, to kick off our celebration year. And doing it around, you know, the New Year's Eve time too is, you know, it's not untypical for people to have celebratory events that are a little fancier because it's, you know, kind of the kickoff and start of a new year.
Right. And, you know, the big thing with that is to really draw interest. I think having, you know, some local, quote unquote, you know, celebrities in some fashion that have a tie here, whether it's, you know, through our local local businesses, families who've been here for a very long time, you know, maybe have somebody speak for just a short period just to talk about, you know, what life has been like. But those are things you could also do ahead of time. So you just run it on a you could put it on a computer and not have to worry about someone going over the time frame. But, you know, there are a lot of different pieces to that. But I definitely feel like we all want it to be, you know, a little bit more elaborate than a traditional event. And we can talk about, you know, what that looks like for all of us, you know, or what the steering committee and the fundraising committee kind of see that as. And we can make sure that that happens.
Sounds great. Anybody have any other thoughts? Okay, let's move on. I had use of color on the logo, yes or no? And I know we had developed the logo way back with Julie Cavaco's husband, Jack, and he did it in black and white. But the question came up of whether or not we want to keep it as it was developed, or if using it with color, just not changing what the logo looked like made sense. So going around the table, Pete, your thoughts.
Yeah, I would go with multiple options, right? Like black and white may be fine for some things, but there's other kinds of, I mean, if you're doing, I don't know, sweatshirts or whatever, it's in, and they have color, you may want a coordinated color to go with it. So I would, my preference would be whatever works, but keep the logo.
Okay. Jay?
I think maybe a color background, which means you don't have to have special inks, so just the paper. So you got black and white on whatever color would work. That would be quick.
But how about on clothing?
So no. Nope, no opinion.
Okay. Okay, Paul jumped off, so I guess we have Jen.
I got the actual files from Julie so we could use it for the postcard. And I think having it, you know, in the color that it is now is just a plain black and white. And I think from what I remember at the beginning of joining the committee was the fact that they, you know, wanted to add different things behind it. which that kind of makes it a little bit more difficult in some way. Keeping it black and white, it keeps it a little more simple. And then when we do, if we do the color t-shirts or whatever that we were talking about selling, we can make the t-shirts the color, or we can do something different if that's how it wants to be. So I'm okay with it as it is. And then we can change the background if we need to, I guess, like everyone else had mentioned.
Okay. From my perspective, I guess we'd want to look at it, but I think allowing the use of color with the appropriate situation, whether it was on some clothing, where just alternating the color of the logo would be a better match. I'm really open to both options of black and white. Pete, is that you back on?
Yeah, it's me back on. Somehow I lost the signal.
Okay, no worries. Jen, do you want to just repeat what you said so Pete can hear it?
Sure. I basically had said that I got the original files from Julie, from Jack, so that way we can use it for the printer. And with it being black and white as it is, I believe when I first joined the committee, it was just mentioned that the color background could change. So if we did it on t-shirts, you would still have the black, writing for everything. But I think there was some commentary as to whether or not people used photographs in the background, like if someone wanted to use the river or someone wanted to use Sugarloaf. I guess there was some conflict on that in the past. So keeping it where it is now and then just changing the background of the color, for t-shirts or whatever we're selling would be fine with me.
And Pete, I said I'm okay either way with the use of color or black and white. So flexible either way. Any other thoughts on that?
I'm flexible either way as well. I mean, so it doesn't matter to me which way we really do it for me.
Well, it sounds like you watch this. We've got an opinion for every possible choice. I guess my question would be, if it was done in deep red or deep green or whatever, what difference does it make? I don't have a problem with black and white on letterhead and stuff like that, but it just, by keeping it black and white, we just cut their possibilities. And I don't see the problem with making it the logo itself multiple colors as long as we maintain the logo.
Well, I think it almost sounds like we're all somewhat leaning that way. So I think obviously as we're going to approach each item that we develop, we'll look at it as we go forward to see how we may want to sway the vote. Clothing versus printed items versus adding other graphics or pictures to how we're using our logo might impact it.
Yeah, well, I think then it comes out as, giving some kind of latitude to people who want to develop various things. If they have options to use color, that just gives them more flexibility, that's all.
Right, if it ends up being a coffee mug or something like that, I mean, black on whatever may be boring. The ability to use some color might be good.
Well, what about looking at each different project? So like say that we have to use it as the standard, but then if someone wants to change it a color for the coffee mug or for a t-shirt or for a banner, then we could vote on it for each of those items. So that way we have a uniform decision when going forward. And then if someone wants to make a modification, we take it under advisement at that point.
That sounds
because
what we may want to do is if we decide to embrace color, we may decide to embrace the same colors for the t-shirts, as the coffee mugs, as the whatever, to kind of keep the diversion to color consistent as well, rather than every color in the rainbow.
I agree with that.
Okay, so we're going to just basically say we're going to look at it by each project that the logo will become involved with.
Yeah, use the standard black and white, and then, you know, look at it moving forward if someone wants to change it. Because, I mean, like, if we want to change it on the coffee mug or something, I think we would, you know, definitely have the 350S, but then also encompass other designs or other things from Deerfield if it's not too expensive. I mean, obviously, we have to see what it costs, but, you know, people aren't just going to buy a boring, something that looks really boring to them. Or
right.
Not appealing, I guess I should say, not boring, but not appealing.
Yeah. And there could be, I mean, I'm not saying we would do this, but there could be something where we do a contest down the road where we have some other image of Deerfield that gets embraced for something, where we do a contest and have people submit. So, you know, I think right now, as you said, Jen, we probably need to look at this by the project as we go forward and see which way we sway. Any other thoughts on the logo?
Yeah, just keep in mind, if you have a dark background, you can use white for the logo text. So that
right.
doubles the possibility.
Mm-hmm.
And if you want to have something like the 4th of July, you could have the background of red, white, and blue, and then have the white of the label still be present. So it just
mm-hmm.
gives more options for making something that's different.
Right, right. Good point. Thank you, Jay.
Sorry, this is Jen popping back on. I accidentally hung up.
Oh, it's you. I wasn't sure if it was Pete again. So hello again. Any other thoughts on the logo before we move on to the parade?
I like your idea of doing something, you know, to make it a little different. If we did a contest at some point, maybe have a t-shirt design or, you know, some kind of an arts and craft contest thing, whether we utilize the kids, you know, in the grade school, we could maybe do a reward for one thing for them and then maybe do something for the high school.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Just a thought.
Yep.
So I
yep.
liked your idea.
Definitely some good thoughts. And, you know, there'll be other considerations. I know one of the events that Sunderland did to involve the elementary kids is just for elementary. They did a birthday cake contest where different students made a birthday cake and decorated it for the town. And they selected winners of a birthday cake contest. So,
that's awesome.
Yeah, it was a very fun thing that they did for the youngsters, you know, to really do their own thing and embrace what the town anniversary was about.
That's great.
Yeah. Okay. So Paul and I met with Brenda and Mike on last Thursday, socially distanced on my back patio. And we had a really great meeting. They said, we want you to ask questions. Well, how do you start to ask questions when you haven't done something like this? So we started with about two or three questions, and then they just talked and talked and talked and talked, and it was so good. They gave us their parade booklet, which has lots of cool information. They had the booklets printed ahead of time and put them in various places around town to advertise the parade. It had a save the date in the front and the time and where the parade was going to be. And they had a few committee pictures. And actually, the birthday cake contest is, it was that weekend. So they talk about that. They talked about parade sponsors. They had a whole list of who were sponsors, not what they sponsored, but just that they were sponsors. donation and support for the parade from various people, police departments and schools and folks that helped out. Special thanks to Holyoke St. Patrick's Day Parade Committee, who helped them immensely. They said they were wonderful people and they gave me contacts.
Keep that, because not to interrupt you, but I wonder if they would have contact information for if we decided to do like a Queen Court at the kickoff. I wonder if they would have information regarding how they do the Colleen thing.
They probably would. I do have information. Then they have all the parade divisions. They had MCs for it because they had a reviewing station that was on North Main Street, a few houses down from the Millstone Market. And they had commentators. And so FCAT was filming the parade, and the microphones were hosted by, they had a connection with Priscilla Ress, who used to be a newscaster on either 22 or 40. Somebody had a connection with her and a local guy, Russ Cranshaw, and they did all the commentating about the various groups, and they had write-ups for each contingency coming through. So they had the various divisions. One neat thing they told us they did is every element of the parade they put on colored index cards. So they had any marching bands were one color, and any, say, public safety from a town, their fire and police and whatever was another color, and floats were a color. And so they color coded on index cards every entry. And they said that made putting the parade together so easy, because you didn't want to have music on music interfering with another group. So you could spread it out with just some walkers or a float. And they just had all these index cards. And as they started putting the parade together, they did it easily because they interspersed things so that they didn't have, a band tripping on another band. And I thought that was a really great idea.
That sounds fantastic.
I know. They said they wanted their parade to have focus, obviously, on local and agriculture and the town history. So with that, you know, they reached out for other groups to participate, but they wanted to keep it really about the local area. Their parade was just under 2 hours long, and they walked 1.4 miles. Now, it sounds very long, like that's a long stretch, but my husband and I put our odometer on start at Sugarloaf Mountain, and when you hit the four-way at the center of town, that's a mile. And I was surprised that that's a mile. They said...
not too long through the center there at all.
They said you don't want your parade to be longer than a mile and a half. Theirs ran 1.4 miles because that's just enough. They started at the Sunderland Elementary School and came the corner to South Main Street, and then went through the lights up to where North Silver Lane is and disperse there. So they said very important things to think about is your route, your staging, your disbanding areas, because you have to have big areas for people to congregate at and then big areas for people to disperse at the end. So kind of looking through this, in various ways, and this is just my husband and I driving around town, because like, what the heck else do we have to do right now? We're retirees and we don't have anywhere to go. So, looking at Sugarloaf Mountain, around the corner from that is our, Mass State Highway Department that has a lot of space for setup that could be tapped. Across the street is the industrial park, where there is some roadways for staging. So that was kind of a nice start place where there, then we could merge to the start of Sugarloaf and come down Sugarloaf. And again, this is just hypothetical. I know we all have to agree on this. If we turn the corner at the downtown and continued just to Pleasant Street, at Pleasant Street, dispersed down Pleasant Street, you would have Deerfield Elementary and Frontier Regional parking areas for pickup for the various groups as well. Where you park everybody else that comes to the parade, that's a whole other question. But these are all things that really have to get dissected because you can say, oh, yeah, it's great. Let's have a parade. Well, there's a lot of particulars. And they talked about CNA cans along the way. And as far as the broadcasting, don't go cheap on sound, because if FCAT's going to tape it, you want to make sure you have a good sound system for your commentators. They made a conscious decision that unless somebody was on a float or in a car, that no child under 12 years old was allowed in the parade. They didn't want various kids on bikes or kids without supervision. And so they said very specifically, no kids under 12. Let the kids watch the parade. They're not going to be in it. And
I think that's good.
And they did say that that was a very good decision. They talked about walkie-talkies and golf carts being essential. And, you know, they were able to negotiate borrowing them from various places. What else? They did not put trash containers out anywhere on the parade route. Their rule was, you have it, you take it home. They didn't want trash containers. They knew that was going to become a problem. And they told us who they got the Santa cans from. It was United Rentals. They said it was really important to figure out volunteers for carrying banners, because you might think you have somebody and then they cancel on you. So you really want to have like an arms list of people that you can go to, because a lot of people bail out, and they did have cancellations at the last minute. They had no backup date. It was either they had it or they weren't having it. So if it was going to be torrential rains or thunderstorms, they weren't going to have a parade. They lucked out with a probably hotter than they needed day, but a beautifully sunny day, and it all came together. I asked them if they would do anything different, having now the foresight to look back. And Brenda, who kept all the books, Mike kept complimenting her on her record keeping. She said she would do nothing different. Everything came out just the way they wanted it. And that was really a very good statement. They gave us the name of their fireworks company. They said their fireworks were $7,000. And I can speak to having watched them. Their fireworks were fabulous. They put on a really great display. And they got a sponsor for the fireworks. That's what I have to say about the parade.
No, that's really detailed and specific, and that's exactly what we need in order to have it go off without hitches.
Yeah. So, I mean, obviously there's a lot of logistics, and I almost think for Paul and I, public safety might be a good place to start to see if our police and EMS team have any thoughts or preferences for, you know, possible routes, because they might have some, you know, public safety thoughts as far as getting, you know, a safety vehicle in or out if they needed to. But I don't know if any of you have any other thoughts for us to follow up on or get started with.
This is Jen. May I give you some feedback?
I would love some. Thank you.
Okay. I've dealt with motorcycle runs with some things like that. So definitely check with the police department and EMS first to see what they would recommend for a route, because they'll tell you the logistics, using the masks, site there on the side, is that going to interfere because that is such a main road or whatnot? But I think Sunderland closed off their 116 for a period of time when they did theirs. So it was, you know, advertised.
They closed 47 for the whole parade, and they closed the bridge accessing Sunderland from Deerfield for 2 hours. They got permission from the state, which was interesting.
No, I think, well, I think you can do it. So I think the first call, you know, would definitely be to ask the police department about that, because if I recall correctly, all of the colleges are usually out and do their graduations in May, right? So we wouldn't have to contend with any of that.
That's correct.
Okay. So I agree with checking with the police department and EMS first. I like the route that you talked about. Do we know where the route was last time? And I'm not asking to copy it again. I'm only asking because I've heard from people saying that there are issues between, you know, Old Deerfield and South Deerfield, and I just want everyone to feel included.
I think that there is consideration of Old versus South, and certainly our town history is largely started and focused around Old Deerfield. However, unless we got permission to use Route 5 and 10, which I'm sure we would not, there's really nowhere to stage and disband a parade, even at a minimum of a mile. There's no place within the body of the village of Old Deerfield to do that. Pete, I don't know if you'd offer any other thoughts.
Well, I would agree with you in terms of Old Deerfield. I mean, you've got one. There's a very large field at the south end of town that ball fields, and you might be able to pull it off. There's only one narrow entrance to it. And at the northern end, it's all agricultural fields and with no, you know, no open spaces. So it's a really hard place to pull it off in Old Deerfield. One of the things I was thinking about in terms of South Deerfield is when you go through town, is Pleasant Street the one the town office is on, or is it the next one up?
Conway Street is the one the town office is on. Pleasant Street is the one where that little car quest or auto or something is on the corner.
Yeah, that's great, because one of the things that when you go down Pleasant Street, you've obviously got the high school and the potential ball field there. You've got the grammar school, but I don't know whether you've been to the grammar school, but there's also a pathway that crosses Bloody Brook behind the grammar school that leads you over in behind the town offices. So if you're running out of space, you could actually mobilize some people behind the town office and still have them or disperse that way. And so there's multiple ways to exit.
Yeah. Jen, did you have any other comments?
I like the organizational stuff on that. I think it's great, you know, that you got such wonderful information from them. So thank you for reaching out to them and getting everything. And I think you and Paul are going to do great. Obviously, you know, even though I'm on the fundraising committee, I'm more than able to help the day of the event, you know, to make sure that you guys have hands on. And I think, hearing all the things that we want to accomplish, I think we need to start advertising more stuff on the Facebook page. I haven't been posting anything because I wasn't sure where we stood on a lot of the different pieces. So now that I have the email address that you sent me, Holly, I want to make sure that, you know, we get as many people to help as possible, because that's going to be a huge, huge event. And I think we should have a rain day possible, but I don't know how that works out with participants. Do you have to get them to agree to a rain date if something were to happen? you know, because that would be losing out on a lot of money. And do they do contracts with their participants in the parade, you know, for the floats and such, like, you know, whether it's the Mummers, the Shriners, or whatever?
They did have documents, and she did share with us a few of the documents that I have to dissect, but they did have something that had to be signed off. I haven't digested them, but they said because of, you know, just planning purposes, that they didn't feel they could expect everybody to go to an alternate date, whether it be the next day or the following weekend, because some of the groups come from far and obviously are booked for other events. So if you are a fife and drum marching band, you probably are getting asked to do multiple events during the course of the summer months, and having you available for a backup. I mean, could we decide that we want to do that ourselves, and we would put that as a contingency, you know, in the contract? If we determined we had to cancel for rain, could you be available on the following date? And then we would know whether or not people could do A or B. And if they could do either, then we could keep them as, you know, but it might abbreviate the parade somewhat, because we would potentially be losing some participants.
Right. No, I understand. I'm thinking of, you know, not even just for the backup date, but just to have a contract to make sure that they come, especially when you have to pay them to appear.
Correct. No, they did have paperwork that people had to sign off on, and they had to sign off on if they were a marching group, that there were not any children under 12. I think they made an exception for a couple of political people who were walking, you know, with their family. I don't know. What's her name? Is it Natalie?
Natalie Bly.
Bly. I think that may have been a consideration where it was a family unit walking together, you know, again, campaigning kind of, or representation of our area, that they allowed some wiggle room, but essentially they didn't want, like at the end of our Memorial Day parade, where the kids are all willy-nilly haphazard on their bikes while riding all over the place.
I agree with that. I agree with the age restriction. I think that's important.
Yeah.
And also, if it's really hot too, you know, they're more, if someone is really young, they could be apt to, you know, heat exhaustion more than someone in a little older. And the same with any elderly participants could, you know, be in the same boat that's not in a car or something. So
right. So, you know, whether there's a rain date or not, that's certainly you know, something that we can all talk about together and decide how we might approach it as we look at our participants. But it could, you know, be a bit of a challenge even for local towns, you know, when we invite our neighbors of Hatfield and Whately and Conway and Sunderland, you know, to have them commit to two different dates, whether it's within the same weekend or back-to-back weekends, might be a bit of a challenge. But we could explore it for sure.
Yeah, I saw with Hatfield's situation, they're adding their parade to the Memorial Day parade, I think, next year.
You know, and maybe if we decided on a rain date that was greatly away from the original date, it might allow, you know, the contingencies to agree to it. You know, maybe, you know, June 10th versus a rain date of September 15th kind of thing, then they may be agreeable. But, you know, again, we'll have to decide how we approach that. I know Hatfield, they basically pushed theirs off nearly a year, if I'm correct.
Yeah, to next year because of the coronavirus. But I believe something was mentioned where they were doing it on Memorial Day.
Mm-hmm. And that could be, you know, because that may be a convenient way to keep the commitment of all the people who are normally part of their Memorial Day event and then add the other groups to it.
Yeah, it says on their website it's rescheduled to May 30th, 2021, which is the Memorial Day that they usually do it.
Okay.
Yeah, to be held in conjunction with the annual Hatfield Memorial Day Parade and festivities.
Okay. Jen, any other thoughts?
No, I think the cost of the fireworks is good. I know Paul had mentioned talking to DCR about the fireworks being up there. So, I mean, you know. Yeah. And I think the other thing, too, just looking why we're talking on the phone, do parades typically cancel for rain? But they say, like, you know, if it's not really heavy rain, it's usually they still keep going with it. So I think that's something, you know, you guys should talk about too. If it's going to be light rain versus, you know, heavy thunderstorm, obviously you'd have to cancel.
Correct. Some groups, I know, if you're familiar with a group called the Mummers, I think they're from the Pennsylvania area. They will not march, I believe, in any rain because their costumes are so elaborate that they don't want to damage them. But I think typically most groups, if there's just light rain, still participate. But that's another question for sure.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's pretty much it for my feedback. Thanks.
Okay. Jay, do you have any feedback? You're muted. We want to hear your lovely.
It sounds good. I don't have any strong opinions on parade stuff, so fine by me anyway.
Okay, thank you. All right. So I think we're good for today, unless somebody's got any other topics. I have for the next meeting. Just to explore Deerfield High School and Frontier Regional alumni and how we might work to contact them through classmates, et cetera. Just to revisit the address that we're going to use for any of our correspondents.
Yeah, the P.O. box, I have to ask the...
Yep. Yeah, fireworks and DCR with Paul to see how we're doing there. And additional committee members.
Yeah, and you could also give me the information for the St. Patrick's committee, just so I could ask, you know, maybe about the Colleen for the Queens thing, if we decide to do that.
Okay.
I mean, is that something you guys are that everyone is comfortable with if we were to try to do something like that again, or?
I think we should at least explore it. I mean, you may decide, but it would be worth exploring.
Great.
Other agenda items for the next time that anybody can think about at the moment?
I think just more solidified dates, like the different, look at the events that we've had in the past, think about events that you've seen at current celebrations for communities and kind of, you know, have more going forward because we have, you know, a good portion for, you know, we've got something for January. If we do the torch thing, that's in February, then the next event is May for the founding date. Then the parade is, you know, weekend is the 7th or the 9, 10, 11 for June. And then if we want to do anything moving forward, you know, for the rest of the year, what kind of things do you want to do?
Okay, that's good. Anybody else anything for the agenda?
I'm good. I don't have anything.
Okay. So, Pete, if you are willing to run the next meeting, which is the last Monday of June, I think we'll be having that one at 5:30 because we've been trying to do morning, evening. Does that make sense to everybody?
Yeah.
What time?
That would be the, what date do we decide? 29th?
Yeah, that would be June 29th.
Yeah, okay.
June 29 at 5:30. Does that work for everybody?
Works for me.
Pete?
Yeah, I'm good.
Okay, Jay? 5:30 on the 29th? Okay, cool. All right, so we'll reconvene. So I will take on the task of developing the agenda, getting it out for you guys to look at in advance of the posting date. So if you want to tweak it, add anything, and I will take responsibility for getting it posted. And then Pete, if you would be willing to run the next meeting off the agenda, would that be okay?
Yeah, that'll work for me, Holly. Just a question is, do we have the same number, telephone number and code for each of the meetings, or how does that work?
You would like to think that that would be a logical thing for the town to do, but I asked that question before this meeting, and I was told it changes for every meeting. Don't know
okay,
why.
So.
I don't know why, but so it'll be on the agenda announcement. So I would get that information from Town Hall. When they schedule it, they assign a phone number, and then that'll be part of the agenda at the top of it, how to call in or go onto your computer remotely.
Okay.
It would be nice at some point if we could have an in-person meeting outside somewhere, but that's all weather contingent, and I don't think we want to touch that one right now.
Yeah,
you know,
the Historic Commission had asked about that. They were told no, because, you know, if we wanted members of the community to come out, they have to, the members of the community have to have access to it, so that's why it had to be on the phone.
Yeah. I know, it's a bummer, because I would much rather see your faces in person and really communicate better, but I think we're doing the best we can for right now.
You know, I'll just throw this out. My house is right there on Main Street. So it's not, you know, it's skip and a jump to the town office, but I've got a big backyard, and if people brought chairs, I'm sure we could set up and have an outside meeting and be perfectly comfortable.
The problem is we can't expect the public to be in your backyard if they want to join us.
Well, we can invite the public and just say where it is.
I guess, Jen, what you're saying, they said no.
Okay. Well, whatever.
I don't know about that or whatnot. I think it was just if we try. John had asked about doing it at the town hall outside, you know, so we could socially distance. And the feedback he got was no, because people from the town have to be there. But if we do the conference call as well, like if someone has a phone on speakerphone, we could still do it in his backyard and still have the town people participating.
That's true. I guess for this next one, let's leave it the way it is, and then we can explore the alternative to see. I can even ask Carolyn whether or not she has any issue with that, because it would really be much easier to meet in person.
Because then you could see the book, or you could see things, or just know what, you know, what we have. And
well, we also don't talk over each other as much when we're in person, because we can visually see that somebody's talking.
Yes, I agree.
A little easier. Anyway, all right, anything else? Because they're going to log us off any second now.
No,
I'm good, Holly.
Okay, I'll promise to get the agenda out in the next week. That way we'll have enough time to tweak it and get it posted before the next meeting on the 29th at 5:30. And thank you all for a really good discussion today.
Thanks, Holly.
Thanks, Holly.
Thanks, everyone.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye.